قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات والله بما تعملون خبيرا صلوات May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all on this occasion of the eve of the viladat of Imam Muhammad Al-Bāqir alayhi salatu wasalam. I would like to begin with ayat number 11 from Surah Al-Mujadila, Surah number 58. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu idha qila lakum tafassahu fil majalis fafsahu yafsahu Allahu lakum. This is an ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basically talking about the importance of the social akhlaq when we are in a gathering, especially when we talk about gathering of the mu'mineen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressing the mu'mineen, he says, all you who believe, when you are told to make room in sitting places for honorable visitors, then make room for them, and Allah will make room for you in paradise. Of course, I'm putting in some words here in translation to make the meaning more clear. And then the ayat goes on to say, وَإِذَا قِيلَ انشُرُوا فَانشُرُوا, and when you are told to get up, you know, give up your seat. And this refers to giving up your seat for a learned, righteous person. Why? Then Allah explains why you should do this. Because يَرْفَعُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمِ دَرَجَاتٍ. Because when you move away and give your seat to the learned, righteous people, why you should do that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for Allah will raise the rank of those of, for Allah raises the ranks of those of you who believe and those who have been given knowledge. Wallahu bima ta'maluna khabir. Allah is well aware of what you do. When we look at this ayat, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has specially accorded, you know, honor and dignity and respect to the righteous, learned individuals. And although the verse is a universal message, you know, can apply in different situations, however, we have to also realize that the best application of this ayat would be the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the imams of Ahlul Bayt, especially including the imam whose wiladat we are celebrating tonight. Our fifth imam, Imam Muhammad Al-Bāqir alayhi salatu wasalam, is popularly known by his title, Al-Bāqir. And as all of you know, you're taught this in the madrasa, that Al-Bāqir is the title given to him by the Prophet long, long before his own birth. And the word Al-Bāqir means, this is actually a short form of Bāqiru ulūmun nabiyyin, means somebody who digs out the knowledge of the Prophets. So as if he's the custodian of this treasure, you know, bestowed upon him, which consists of the knowledge of Anbiya, which was all to put together and given to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also the special knowledge that Allah gave to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then that is, was then conveyed to the imams. And so he's the custodian of that knowledge, and it was the historical circumstances which gave him the opportunity to dig out that knowledge and share with the Ummah. So he was the true heir of the prophetic knowledge. And as far as the Shi'i history is concerned, he formally established the system of training his disciples, his companions, by teaching them and training them in various religious sciences. Salawat upon the Akbar. Imam Muhammad Al-Bāqir alayhi salatu wasalam trained many of his companions to become good scholars, righteous scholars. You know, when we sometimes hear these words that, you know, there are some people, some elements in, among Shias also, sometimes they say, well, our ulama, they're good people, they're righteous people, they are scholars. We do realize when we use these words like righteous scholars, this is something more appropriate for the companions of the imams. Imams are actually the wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have been appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is their companions, their ashab, who are ulama abrar in that way. They are even above that level. So we cannot just look at the imam to be righteous scholars also. No, only righteous scholars. No, they are actually more than that. And these were the companions of the imams who actually further conveyed the teachings of the imam to the Shia community. Imam al-Baqir's era was very important from the historical point of view. And this is where I have to give a little bit of history of the past before we come to the fifth imam. Because we, when we look at this phenomenon of hadith, the sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we see that the khulafa from day one, from the days of Abu Bakr, the campaign started to actually suppress the ahadith of Rasulullah in the name of protecting the Quran. Verbal transmission of the ahadith was discouraged, strongly, you know, opposed. And this was even intensified during the time of the second Khalifa. That he actually brought some of the prominent companions who had been assigned different positions in different cities, he called them back and he said, you know, I've heard that you have been spreading the ahadith of Rasulullah among the people, and I don't want you to do this. Therefore, I confine you to the city of Medina. You are not allowed to go out of here. And so verbal transmission of hadith was prohibited. A written form of hadith was not even tolerated. Whatever was gathered, even by the first Khalifa, he first of all asked people to bring those writings, and then he burned them, destroyed them. And this is where this was continued by the Khulafa who came later on. You know, even when we talk about the era of the Banu Umayyah, all the way till the time of the Khalifa known as Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. And Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is one of the Khulafa of the time of Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is where we see that he's the one who actually lifted this prohibition of gathering and writing hadith. And there is this is a vast subject by itself, you know, what were the motivation? What were the factors which changed this person, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, to actually go against the policy of the previous Khulafa, all the way from Abu Bakr to his own time? Of course, Amir al-Mu'minin is exception to this whole group. And this is where, you know, there are many, many reasons given. One of them is that, you know, he was relatively most just among the Banu Umayyah, a good person in that way. And so they say because of his goodness, you know, he was a khair. And therefore, this is one of the things he did, just as he also prohibited the tradition of cursing Amir al-Mu'mineen in Friday khutbas, which had been going on for about 50 to 70 years. However, there are other scholars who actually have studied this issue more deeply, including our grand marja, Ayatullah Sistani. May Allah prolong his life. He has a discussion on the issue of the history of compilation of hadith. And in that risala, he actually brings up this point. What were the motivations? And he talks about other motivations, but he says that there is one point that people don't talk about more. He says the Khulafa suppressed the ahadith. Although they officially suppressed the ahadith, but they were not able to fulfill, you know, fully control this process. What happened was that this tradition of circulation of hadith went underground. away from the public arena and the eyes of the government. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, according to Ayatollah Sistani, he says he was a clever khalifa. He allowed the writing of ahadith, lifted that prohibition, so that, you know, the whole process of circulation of ahadith will now come out of the shadows, and perhaps he will be able to control its direction. That was the motivation, or at least part of the motivation, that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, you know, lifted this prohibition of narrating and writing ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From the Shi'i point of view, you know, the statements of the Prophet and the Imams collectively is known as hadith. And the scholar companions of our Imams became the custodian of the Imams' teachings. Sometimes, you know, of course, there were many, many companions who would just hear. But there were many who actually would come down with their pen and writing material. You know, sometimes they wrote down in their notebooks. Sometimes they just, and they would also then narrate to other Shias. And among those who wrote down these ahadiths, some would then even go and kind of make a good copy of it. And some of them would just recopy whatever they had heard. But others went a step ahead. And what they did was they actually looked at the subject and the themes of the ahadith, and they would put the ahadith of one subject in one notebook. And so this tradition of the thematic, you know, even compilation of the notebooks which had the sayings of Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salam, and after him Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam, because most of the ahadith that we have in the Shia tradition come from the fifth and the sixth Imam. And this is where we see that in history, by the time of Ghaybat al-Sughra, when the imamat of our present Imam Ajallallahu Ta'ala Faraju al-Sharif started, salawat from him, the era which is known as the era of Ghaybat al-Sughra, by that time they were around Usul Arba'mi'ah. It is known as 400, you know, notebooks. Shaykh Kulaini, the compiler of the first collection of Shia hadiths, actually used this 400 notebooks as his source. Means these were the notebooks which were coming from the days of the fifth Imam, sixth Imam, and then going on to companions and their disciples. And Shaykh Kulaini, in a way, was able to put all this together. It took him almost, you know, from what I call can recall, 20 years to do that. And when he put it together, this is where then he compiled Al-Kafi. You know, he basically gathered the ahadith, categorized them according to the subject, and placed them in the appropriate, you know, sections. And this is where you had the first collection of the Shia hadith. This tradition of preserving the ahadith of the Imams continued. Other collections were prepared gradually after Sheikh Kulaini. Sheikh Saduq comes in, and then Sheikh Tusi comes in. And so when you look at the historical time of the early days of Ghaybat, you have one book, Al-Kafi, multi-volume book, of course, by Sheikh Kulaini. Then you have another book by Sheikh Saduq, multi-volume, known as Man La Yahdurhu Al-Faqih. And they have another collection of hadith by Sheikh Tusi, actually two collections. One known as Al-Istibsar, and the other one was known as Tahzib. And so these four books, one of Kulaini, one of Saduq, and two of them from Sheikh Tusi, they basically are known as Al-Kutub Al-Arba'a, the four canonical books of the Shia Hadith. These are the early day compilation of the hadith of the Shia tradition. Salawat from the Barar. So what we see here, that the process which was started by Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wasalam to share the ahadith of Rasulullah and to teach to the companions so that they may also retain in their memory as well as put that in writing so it can be preserved for the generations to come, you know, our scholars became the beneficiary of these this hard work and the processes initiated by Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wasalam. And the ulama, the scholars then developed various sciences to verify and scrutinize the authenticity of the hadith. And also, you know, ilm al-hadith came in, how to understand the ahadith and how to, you know, bring the ahadith together. And this became a very important element for development of what is known as Islamic jurisprudence, fiqh, you know, Islamic laws. And this tradition continued. You have Kulaini, Shaykh Saduq, Mufid, Sayyid Murtaza, Shaykh Tusi. Shaykh Tusi is the founder of the Hawza Ilmiya of Najaf 1,000 years ago when he moved from Baghdad to Najaf. And this went on, and after that we see, for example, you come to the era of Allama Hilli, Shahili Awwal, the center of learning would move from Najaf to Hilla, to Samarra, then it goes on to Isfahan, you have Allama Majlisi there. This is where we come to realize that, you know, our ulama continued this tradition and just cherished the knowledge that they gained from the hadith of Sadiqain, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salam and Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wa salam. Salawat. One of the important points I would like to share with you is that many of our senior mujtahideen from the days of Kulaini till the present time, they have this tradition of the ijazah of riwayat or the ijazah of hadith, where a teacher would give a written certificate to the student that you are allowed to quote these ahadith through me. And so the teacher has an ijazah from his teacher, the generation before, and you can actually trace these ijazahs, these certificates of the mujtahideen from one generation to another continuously without any missing link, going all the way to Shaykh Kulaini and through his or Shaykh Saduq, and through their chain of narrators from the Ashab to the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salatu wasalam themselves. These ijazas these days, they have just value to it. It doesn't have an academic value as such, but this is a very important point to keep in mind, that there is a continuity and there is a link among the, family of scholarship going all the way from Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salam to the present Maraji. Salawat from the Ikbara. Tonight I would like to take the opportunity to talk about a student from the broader school of Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wasalam, a contemporary, you know, scholar of our own time, the grand Ayatullah Shaykh Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi, Gulpaygāni, who passed away on Monday in Qum. He was one of the leading and grand marja of the Hawza Ilmi of Qum. Ayatullah Shaykh Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi, he was born in 1919 and he passed away on the 1st of, actually he was born on 12th February 1919 and he died on the 1st February, actually he died yesterday, yes, on the 1st February, year 2022. He initially studied in his own, you know, village known as Gulpaygāni. That's why he was also known as Gulpaygāni. Don't confuse him with the Grand Ayatullah Gulpaygāni, who lived, who was the Marja in the early 90s. Sayyid Muhammad Raza Gulpaygāni Musavi was the father-in-law of Shaykh Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi Gulpaygāni. So Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi Gulpaygāni initially studied in Gulpaygāni, then went to Qom, studied under prominent scholars of the time. Then he also went and spent some time in Najaf to study under the prominent scholars of Najaf. However, the most influential figure in his life, as far as his studies is concerned, was the Grand Ayatullah Muhammad Hussein Burujardi, Rahmatullah Alayhi. He was the global marja during the late 50s and early 60s. He died in 1961. And he was, when I say global, he was the only marja followed by all the Shias, you know, around the world. And he was very close to Ayatollah Burujardi, student teacher relationship, to the extent that Ayatollah Burujardi would actually trust him to an extent of making him the head of Majlis-e-Istifta. Majlis-e-Istifta is actually the committee which responds to the questions which are sent to the marja. You can realize that, you know, for example, Ayatollah Sistani, you know, must be getting thousands, if not hundreds of, you know, questions every day. He doesn't sit down and respond to each one of them. You know, so the Maraja basically select their senior students, and they have this committee of istifta, of fatwas. They would sit down, look at the responses, and they would write the answers based on their knowledge of the opinion of their teacher. And some, many times the teacher would review them and either accept it or correct it. Or sometimes, you know, depending on if it's a very simple question, they would just, you know, respond to it and put the seal of the office of the marja. Many times you will see the marja himself will review it and put his seal and his signature. And so Ayatollah Burujardi trusted his student, Shaykh Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi, appointed him as the head of the Majlis-e-Istifta. After the revolution of the of Iran, you know, in the first election which was held to organize the Constitutional Assembly, Shaykh Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi was one of the members elected from the city of Qom. He was also a member of Shura-e Nigahban, the Council of Guardians. There are six mujtahideen and six constitutional lawyers who actually vet all the bills which are passed by the parliament to see whether it is according to the constitution and according to the Sharia or not. And so he was a very prominent figure, even trusted by the late Imam Khomeini. One of the, and this is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him a long life. MashaAllah, he lived for 102 years. When he died, he was 102 years old. And one of the greatness of our maraji, without any exception, I would say, is that they might become very old, physically very weak and feeble, but they are mentally alert and aware. You can sit down and talk to him, to them, and they will respond, even though their voice will be very faint, you know, but they will hear, they will understand, and they will respond to you. The Grand Ayatollah Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi leaves a very rich scholarly legacy in form of 83 publications on various topics. This is besides his ijtihadi lectures on jurisprudence and the principles of jurisprudence. So he was a jurist and an excellent mujtahid, who in a way took the place of his father-in-law later on and gradually emerge as a marja by himself. But besides, you know, ijtihad and fiqh and jurisprudence, from very beginning, he had a special interest in the matters of theology and aqidah, the belief system. And he was an expert on the level of research as well as on the level of responding to the doubts raised by non-Shias as well as those from the Shi'i community. You know, let me just give you two examples. There was a book written by a person by the name of Shaykh Salihi Najafawadi. And he wrote a book about Imam Hussain alayhi salam, and the title was Shaheed Jawed, Eternal Martyr. And he talks about the purpose of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, why he took the stand against Yazid. In his book, Salihi Najafawadi, and this was the book which was published in 1968, he actually denies that Imam Hussain alayhi salam didn't know at all what will be the final outcome, that he will be killed. You know, we hear about the prophecy about his martyrdom from Rasulullah, from Bibi Fatima, from Amir al-Mu'mineen, you know, and Imam Hussain alayhi salam also, yes, knew about it. And this is a whole discussion where we have talked in the month of Ramadan, in our talks about ilmi ghaib, the knowledge of the unseen as far as the events are concerned, and the actions of the imam or the prophet who has that knowledge but still goes through the events according to the normal process of cause and effect. And so this fellow, Salihi Najafawadi, denied that Imam Hussain alayhi salam had any knowledge about what will happen. And he had gone there in order to seek power and government. And in the process, basically, he rejects the ilm al-ghayb of the imams. When this book was published, it created a commotion in Iran. You know, it's a Shia country. Many scholars, you know, wrote rebuttal to his analysis and his arguments, including the famous, you know, scholar of the century, Allama Tawatabai, the famous author of the Tafsir al-Mizan. He also wrote an extensive article on this topic of ilmi ghaib of the imam, especially referring to Imam Hussain alayhi salam. However, the most extensive and scholarly rebuttal to that book of Salihi Najafawadi was written by Shaykh Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi. He was not known as Ayatullah or Grand Marja at that time, but he was a senior scholar at that time. And the title that he gave to his book was very appropriate. And he named it as Shaheed-e-Agah. Shaheed-e-Agah means the martyr who was aware. You know, kind of talking about this issue of the ilmi ghaib of the imams, and especially referring to Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And Shaykh Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi's book was published in early 70s. And so let me, you know, just a side point for our youths and those who are interested in studying. Remember all these questions that we get these days, especially in the social media, denying ilmi ghaib of the imam. These are nothing new. This have come centuries ago. These things have come even a generation ago. And the answers were given. You have this book of, you know, Salihi Najafawadi, you know, denying the ilmi ghaib of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. You have, for example, the response of Shaykh Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi in form of Shaheed-e-Agah. And so, you know, those who are influenced by the Wahhabi thought and thinking, you know, they are not really bringing anything new. These are, you know, same things. People don't know, probably have not heard about it before, and therefore they sometimes get mesmerized and say, oh, we didn't know about it. These are the issues which have already been tackled and discussed. So this was the first example I wanted to share of the work of Grand Ayatollah Luṭfullāh, Ṣāfi, on this issue of ilm al-ghayb and aqidah. Another point that we have to realize about Ayatullah Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi is that his attention and focus on Imam Mahdi ajallahu ta'ala faraj sharif. He was the expert during his time on the issue of Mahdawiyyat. He was even encouraged by people like Ayatollah Burujerdi to work on this topic. And one of the main's books as far as a reference on the issue of Imam Mahdi alayhi salam is concerned is a book written by him many, many years ago, decades ago, Muntakhabul Athar fil Imam Thani Ashar, which means the selected ahadith about the 12th Imam. And this is in three volumes. He was very active, even before his marja'iyyat, and even after his marja'iyyat, in responding to the doubts raised by Sunnis, as well as the Wahhabi, you know, influences about the issue of Mahdawiyyat, the concept of Mahdi, the savior, the issue that the 12th Imam is there, you know, even according to the Sunni ahadith and traditions. He has, for example, a booklet known as Isalat al-Mahdawiyyat, and also one very interesting book known as Guftamane Mahdawiyyat, you know, discourse on Mahdawiyyat. It is actually in question form, question answer forms. So there is a question, and then he responds to it in detail, and then another question. It's interesting, if you look at all those questions in this book known as Guftamane Mahdawiyyat, actually they all come from this English book known as Islamic Messiahism, you know, by Dr. Sachadina. Means all the questions raised there, you know, he puts that as a question and then responds to them. Actually, there is also another writing of his in English, which is known as Pasukhi Bikitabi Aqidai Mahdaviyyat Dashiya Imamiyya, answer to the book on the doctrine of Mahdawiyyat in Shia Islam, which is actually responding to the thesis of Dr. Sachadina. So I just wanted to give you a perspective about him that many people didn't know about him. That he was one of the senior, you know, marajah of our time. And his expertise in the matters of aqidah is there, and he has really contributed quite a lot. And many of his works, especially on Mahdawiyyat, have been translated in English, and they are available, you know, if you Google, and you will be able to find, or even go to al-islam, alislam.org, you will be able to find things on that website also. The Grand Ayatullah Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi Gulpaygāni died on Monday, on Tuesday, and today was his janaza in Qom. And after the janaza in Qom, basically is already early morning next day there, his body will be taken to Najaf, where there will be another funeral process, and the janaza would be, namaza janaza would be recited there in Najaf. And then his body will be taken to Karbala, where there will be another, you know, third process, the ceremony of namaza janaza. And then he will be buried according to his wish in one of the rooms in the vicinity of the Haram of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. Let us conclude this part of my talk with a Surah Fatiha for the departed soul, Shaykh Luṭfullāh Ṣāfi Gulpaygāni. Al-Fatiha. Salawat. when we talk about Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wasalam, you know, as the Imam who is known as Baqir ulum al-Nabiyyin, the one who digs out the knowledge of the prophets, this is where we have to realize that, you know, besides the gift of the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to him specially, you know, him and the other Imams, they're also the custodian of the written documents which were left by the Prophet and Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam. For example, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir in his conversation with Jabir al-Ju'fi, he says, Ya Jabir, إِنَّ لَوْ كُنَّا نُحَدِّسُكُمْ بِرَعْيِنَا وَحَوَانَا لَكُنَّا مِنَ الْهَالِكِينَ, that if we narrate to you based on our own personal, you know, opinion or our desire and whims, then we would be among those who will perish. وَلَكِنَّا نُحَدِّسُكُمْ بِأَحَادِيثٍ نَكْنِزُهَا عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَمَا يَنْكِزُ هَؤُلَاءِ ذَحَبُهُمْ وَفِذَّتُهُمْ. O Jabir, if we narrate to you based on our own opinion or whims, we will be perished. Rather, we narrate to you the narrations that we have treasured, preserved as a treasure from the Prophet, just as the people, you know, treasure their gold and silver. So he's the one who dug that treasure out. And it's interesting to see this connection between the written documents which we survived till the days of the fifth and the sixth Imam. And so let me go to a narration from Shaykh Kulaini about it, where he quotes from Ali ibn Ibrahim al-Qubbi, going all the way to Sulaym bin Qais. Sulaym bin Qais was a reliable, you know, companion of Amir al-Mu'mineen, a loyal companion. And he was there when Imam was making the formal, you know, last will in the gathering of his own family, you know, his children and grandchildren. Sulaym says, I was there. He was a close companion. And he says, I witnessed the will of Amir al-Mu'mineen when he appointed his son al-Hasan as his wasi and successor. Then he made Hussein. And Muhammad Hanafiya and all his other sons and the elders of his Shias, so the companions were also there, senior ones. And his family is witness to his will. According to Sulaym bin Qais, ثُمَّ دَفَعَ إِلَيْهِ الْكِتَابِ وَالسِّلَاحِ, then Amir al-Mu'mineen gave the written documents and the sword of Rasulullah to Imam Hassan. After saying that you are my successor and my wasi, وَقَالَ لِإِبْنِ الْحَسَنِ, and then Ali alayhi salam says to Hassan, يَا بُنَيَّ أمرني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم أن عوسي إليك, that oh my son, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم has commanded me that I should make this will to you, وعن أدفع إليك كتبي وسلاحي, and I should give you my books and my you know, my my swords. كما أوصى علي رسول الله ودفع علي كتبه وسلاحه, just as Rasulullah made the will to me that I'm the successor and gave me his books and his you know, weapons, similarly I'm doing the same thing because you are my successor. وأمرني, then Ali says to Hassan that Rasulullah has commanded me, أن أمرك, that I should let you know, إذا حضرك الموت أن تدفعها إلى أخيك حسين, when your death comes to you, then you will hand over these things to your brother حسين, who will be your successor. ثم أقبل إلى ابنه الحسين, then according to Sulaym bin Qais, you know, Amir al-Mu'mineen then turns to his son Hussein. And he says, وَأَمَرَكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, And Rasulullah through me has commanded you أن تدفعها إلى ابنك هذا. Rasulullah has commanded you to convey these books and the weapons to your this son. And he pointed towards Ali Zain al-Abidin, who was very young at that time, but he was alive. During the last days of Amir al-Mu'minin, he was there in that gathering. So Amir al-Mu'minin says to Hassan, you will give these things to Hussein. Then he says to Hussein, Rasulullah said that you will give all these things to your son, Ali Zain al-Abidin. Summa akhadha biyadi Ali bin Hussein. According to Sulaym bin Qais, then Amir al-Mu'minin took the hand of Ali ibn Hussein, his grandson, who was very young. And he said to Ali ibn Hussein, وَأَمَرَكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أَن تَدْفَعْهَا إِلَىٰ إِبْنِكَ مُحَمَّدْ بِنْ عَلِي. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has commanded you, O Ali ibn Hussein, that you should give these books and the weapons to your son, Muhammad bin Ali, who is not yet born. This is Imam Muhammad al-Baqir he is talking about. Wa aqra'uhu min Rasulillah wa min as-salam. And then Ali says to Imam Zain al-Abidin, convey Rasulullah and my salam to your son Muhammad bin Ali, who is now known as al-Baqir. Salawat. And so this is where we come to realize that, you know, this whole process of, you know, successorship, the link, especially, you know, these Kitab Ali, it's a very famous, you know, document where Amir al-Mu'minin had written down many, many rules and the regulations of the Sharia. And sometimes Imam Muhammad al-Baqir and Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq would actually, you know, share those, show the book to some of their close companions that see this verdict that I given to you, this is based on this writing of Ali bin Abi Talib. And so when we talk about this issue of, you know, imamat for us, this is actually the direct chain that we have from the Ahlul Bayt going to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Salawat. امام محمد باقر علیہ السلام کی ولادت با سعادت کی اس محفل میں کچھ چیزیں ہم نے امام کی کنٹریبیوشن کے لحاظ سے اور جو میراث انہوں نے علمی طور پر جو چھوڑی ہے جس کے آثار ابھی تک مجتہدین کی کاوشوں میں ان کی تحقیق میں ان کے علم میں آپ کو یہ آثار نظر آ رہے ہیں یہ جو سوال ہم لوگوں سے پوچھا جاتا ہے کہ بھئی آپ لوگ اہل بیت پر اصرار کیوں کرتے ہیں یو نو کیوں آپ صحابہ کو وہی مرتبہ نہیں دیتے ہیں اس کا جواب بہت کچھ ہے ہمارے پاس یو نو خداوند عالم نے قرآن میں جو حکم دیا ہے محبت کا وہ قربا کے لیے ہے قرابت داروں کے لیے ہے صحابہ کے لیے نہیں ہے یہ نہیں ہے کہ ہم انہیں کنڈیم کرتے ہیں نہیں لیکن بارتا محبت کی بات ہے اطاعت کی بات ہے اسوہ حسنہ کی بات ہے اس لیے کہ ہمیں جو ان سے ملتا ہے وہ ہمیں بھروسہ ہے ان کی باتوں پہ یہ ایک ڈائریکٹ چینل ہے ہمارے لیے رسول اللہ کی سنت اور ان کی تعلیم کی طرف مثال کے طور پہ آپ دیکھیں کہ خود امام محمد باقر علیہ السلام اپنے اصحاب سے کہتے ہیں کہ کبھی کبھی وہ سوال ہوتا تھا امام سے اور امام جب جواب دیتے تھے اور اس میں فرماتے تھے کہ رسول اللہ نے یہ کہا ہے وہاں لوگ پوچھ سکتے تھے کہ بھئی رسول اللہ اور آپ میں اچھا خاصا گیپ ہے آپ نے رسول اللہ کو دیکھا تو نہیں ہے کس طرح سے آپ یہ بیان کر رہے ہیں تو امام نے اس وقت جو ہے جواب دیا ہے فرماتے ہیں اذا حدثت الحديث فلم اسنده اگر ہم کوئی حدیث بیان کریں رسول اللہ کی اور تمہیں سند نہ بتائیں تو تم ایزیوم کر لو فرض کر لینا فسندی فیہ کہ میری سند اس سلسلے میں میرے بابا ہیں جنہوں نے ہمارے دادا حسین سے سنا ہے جنہوں نے ہمارے پردادا علی سے سنا ہے جنہوں نے ہمارے جد رسول اللہ سے سنا ہے اور خود رسول نے جبرائیل سے سنا ہے اور جبرائیل نے خداوند عالم سے سنا ہے جب ہمارے پاس یہ سلسلہ ہے تو ہمیں ادھر ادھر جانے کی ضرورت ہے ہی نہیں دوسرے لوگ قابل احترام ضرور ہیں صاحب علم بھی ہوں صاحب تقویٰ بھی ہوں خداوند عالم انہیں جزائے خیر دے لیکن اس ٹائپ کی کریڈیبلٹی یا اس ٹائپ کے کا سلسلہ جو ڈائریکٹ ہو یہ ہمیں کہیں اور نہیں ملتا ہے اور اس لیے ہم ائمہ اہل بیت کو دوسروں پر ترجیح دیتے ہیں اور یہی وہ معیار ہے جو امام محمد باقر علیہ السلام نے بیان کیا ہے کہ جو کچھ ہم کہتے ہیں ہم نے اپنے بابا سے لیا ہے انہوں نے اپنے بابا سے لیا ہے انہوں نے ہمارے دادا سے لیا ہے اور انہوں نے ہمارے جد رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وآلہ وسلم سے لیا ہے صلوات خداوند عالم کی بارگاہ سے دعا ہے خداوند اس قلیل بات قبول فرما ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے ہمارے توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما خداوند یہ کرونا وائرس کی جو بلا ہے جلد سے جلد تمام انسانوں کو اس سے نجات کامل عنایت فرما عالم اسلام میں صلح اور امن کی فضا پیدا کر خداوند شیعوں کو اپنے حفظ امان میں رکھ خصوصاً جو تکفیری حرکتیں ہیں اور جو تحریکات ہیں اور ان کے جو ریزورسز ہیں خداوند انہیں نیست و نابود فرما امام کے ظہور میں تعجیل فرما ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم مبارک ہو انشاءاللہ